Thank you, Gerben. I hope everybody's hearing me okay. Welcome to this talk about the irritability of beach sediment by aeolian forcing. This is something that kept me busy over the past couple of months, or maybe a bit longer. And I'm very happy to present some first results. And apart from presenting you with some new stuff, a mobile wind tunnel and some of the results, it's also a lot of work in progress. And I hope to engage in more research along the lines that I'm presenting today. My name is Siert de Vries. I work at Delft University and Technology. And this particular work I've been doing with colleagues from TU Delft and also some master students that helped in the field. The scope of this research is the assumption that aeolian sediment transport is the main driver for the growth of coastal dunes. However, some dunes grow faster than other dunes, and I wonder to what extent aeolian sediment transport rates can explain this variability in dune growth. And in line with that, I ask myself the question, what causes differences in aeolian sediment transport rates? And there is, of course, an easy answer to that question, and that is, that's wind. Eh? Classic relations dictate that if winds are stronger, more sediment is being transported, and that has been described as early as the 1940s by Becknold. And Becknold started to relate wind-driven sediment transport capacity to some form of the third power of the wind speed, corrected with a threshold. And many sediment transport formulations that are based on this principle are available in literature, and they have been modified and used extensively in several decades of studies that followed. A nice overview is, for instance, provided by Doug Sherman and Bi-Liang Li, that discuss different sediment transport formulations that are all based on the same principle, that there is a nonlinear relationship between sediment transport rates and wind speed. And this makes the fluctuation in wind speed the dominant driver of the variability of the sediment transport. It should be noted that this assumption is, or this equation is dependent on the assumption that sediment supply is abundant. As sediment needs to be in the system to be transported to the extent that is prescribed by this relationship. And this assumption that sediment supply is abundant might not be valid on the beach. And I will explain that if we, for instance, have visualize a surface of on an arbitrary beach, and we have winds blowing from left to right. And then on top of this beach, I have a control volume. A control volume in which we assume some wind forcing can cause sediment transport. Now, if I'm interested in the sediment transport that leaves this control volume, let's call that QF, the flux downwind, three things are important. The sediment transport capacity that is prescribed by the wind speed, so U to the power 3, according to Becknold, in the control volume, the upwind sediment supply, that is not necessarily equal to the downwind sediment flux. And the sediment supply from the bed in the control volume. Okay, so now let's constrain the problem a little bit and assume that the upwind sediment supply is zero. For instance, because we have onshore winds at the beach and the water line is present there, and no sediment can be mobilized when it's underwater. And now only two things are important. The carrying capacity of the wind again, and the sediment supply at the bed. And let's give this sediment supply at the bed, or this erodibility, so to say, a name. Let's call this K in kilogram per square meter per second. Well, in this system, the sediment transport capacity and erodibility together determine the sediment flux at the end. If this erodibility, if K is zero, there will be no sediment flux leaving our control volume regardless of the amount of wind. And this can, for instance, physically happen because when it rains, the beach is wet and the sediment is not erodible. If sediment supply is abundant, K is infinite, the sediment flux leaving the control volume will be equal to the transport capacity of the wind. And in most literature, this relationship, the direct relationship between wind speed and sediment flux, is assumed. But in beach situation, we know that limitation in sediment supply are important, and that is described by the relationship between these parameters. And this relationship is not yet quantified yet. And in this study, I want to quantify the relation between the erodibility of the bed and the sediment fluxes that are governed by that. So I did some digging in the literature on erodibility because I thought, well, this cannot be new, huh? And I found quite some literature on erodibility in deserts and agricultural lands. This literature is actually quite rich and was driven by the interest regarding land degradation after changing crops or droughts, where agricultural land experienced heavy wind erosion. And I found concepts that describe the erodibility factor, K, that I introduced, and reports that state that the erodibility can actually vary in space and in time. And the erodibility is sometimes measured using mobile wind tunnels on agricultural field and in deserts, such as here, presented by our Chinese colleagues, Zhang et al, 2014. And this really inspired me a lot. However, I have found no studies that relate erodibility of soil in relation to the exchange of soil from one place to the other, like the things that we're typically interested in, the sediment transport from the beach to the dune, for instance. This balance this mass balance of sediment is quite often not addressed in these studies. So time for a dedicated experiment that relates sediment erodibility of the beach to sediment fluxes. So the aim of this study is to answer this question. How does erodibility vary in space and time on an arbitrary beach? And I want to develop some new technology to do this and present you today a wind tunnel prototype to study erodibility on the beach. The wind tunnel consists of three parts. The fan, that is a 12-volt battery-powered van. It's connected to a solar panel, and it can generate winds up to 10 meters per second. Then we have the test section. It's 1 meter and 20 centimeter long, a bit shorter. And it has like a plexiglass side. And it has a 25 by 25 square cross-section. And then we have this the trap. And at this stage, the trap is made from some fabric that lets air through, but traps the sediments inside. And in this case, we used some of the students' bed linen. And well, we are still in a conceptual phase when it comes to the trap, but it actually worked quite well for the concept. So with this mobile structure, we could apply wind shear over the sediment bed for a significant period and measure the sediment fluxes weighted at the end of the trap and divide it by time and see how much the flux was. So, well, I think you can see where this is going. Huh? We have a constant wind condition. We measure the sediment flux and we try to derive the erodibility. So let's have a look at the results. I will show you some results from the side of the wind tunnel. and this is a little movie, so I hope this comes through well. Huh? There we go. So looking through the sidewall here, turning on the van, we can see sediment is creeping over the surface. And when I saw this for the first time, I actually started doubting about my story about erodibility, because you know, sediment is not really dislodged from the bed and moving downwind. We mainly see sediment moving on the bed in downwind direction. And after these 30 seconds, we can at least say that sediment is moving, which is the good news. So we are going to look at the next 30 seconds. Yeah. And now I want you to focus on this erosion pin. There's a small pin here, and we can see here. So I turn on the fan again. We can see here that while it's not very clear that sediment is dislodging from the bed, we see that the sediment around the pin is actually eroding, and there are other pins as well, in the wind tunnel that can be used to sort of look at this erosion. So we're only looking at a 30 second period, in total a 1 minute period. And then when we compare this erosion pin to the previous, we see an erosion of about 1 centimeter. Which made me very happy, because we get erodibility, or we can measure erodibility there. And then finally, at the exit of the wind tunnel, it looks a bit like this. This is where we place our trap. At the end of the wind tunnel, weighing this sand that comes out. So really, there are sort of clouds of sand being transported to the downwind end of the wind tunnel. So. We kept the wind speed constant doing 3 runs. And every 5 minutes, we measured how much sediment leaves the wind tunnel. And in this figure, these measurements are summarized. Each measurement, each of the 3 measurements, we move the wind tunnel to another location to start with the fresh measurement with a new sediment bed on the beach. And the main result at this stage is that we see a decreasing trend in the collected sediment in the trap. The first 5 minutes interval show the largest sample sizes by weight. So up to 3 kilograms of sand with an average of 2.5 kilograms of sand were collected during a 5 minute period. And then in the last 5 minute period, so we turn on the fan again for several times. And in the last 5 minute period, this amount of sediment was reduced to 500 grams, which is 5 times less than in the first 5 minutes, keeping the wind constant. So to summarize, our erodibility, kilograms per square meter per second, decreases with time, while the wind speeds are constant over just the course of 30 minutes of wind. So, you know, if you have a high wind event, those are much longer than these 30 minutes. Okay, so after the measurement, we remove the wind tunnel and we can look at the sediment surface, and it looks a bit like this. Or it looks actually exactly like this. We see erosion pins being undermined by several centimeters of erosion. You can see them there. Some of them have even fallen down. And what we can also see is like really that the wind is scraping off this top layer of sediment. And then I carefully wondering if this surface that we measured in the wind tunnel resembles the surface that we typically see during wind events, such as here on the photo. So also here we see this scraping of sediment, of the sediment surface by the wind. And this could imply that during wind events, the erodibility of the bed decreases as the wind events proceeds in time. And it would have a major influence on the type of sediment transport modeling I'm doing, because it would disconnect specify the relationship between sediment transport and wind velocity. Well, at this stage, the step is a bit too large to make more specific conclusion than this. But this is the line along which I want to continue studying Aeolian sediment transport. So to conclude, this study shows the early results of measurements of erodibility using a new mobile wind tunnel and results show that the erodibility of the sediment surface in the wind tunnel varies with time, while wind conditions are approximately constant. And this implies that when time develops, sediment transport is limited because sediment supply is limited. Where I expect that sediment supply is governed by the erodibility of the sediment surface. And this might be a key factor that drives Aeolian processes. And maybe this can explain the variability in dune growth that we typically measure. And of course, we anticipate that this in-situ wind tunnel experiments can be an important instrument to feed this research with data. So the outlook, the follow-up question is quite interesting. What causes erodibility to vary? And the obvious candidates are moisture content, sediment sorting, but also the wind speed itself, which can cause some non-linearity there. And I would like you to tell you some more about this soon, but first I need a bit more toys in the wind tunnel. Toys to measure exactly those parameters, wind speed, sediment forcing, and moisture content, and also the bed level changes. And currently I'm working on an update. So with that, I would be happy to take your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Siert, for this very interesting presentation. A few questions have popped up in the Q&A. Thank you for those. The first question that actually came in was, what is actually the size of the effect of the size of the wind tunnel on your results? Would you, for example, have found the same if the wind tunnel had been substantially longer?
At this stage, I can only speculate. I think there are things that scale linear. I mean, the amount of surface that you blow your wind over will scale. Will be twice as big if your wind tunnel is twice as big, and that's currently the main thing I'm focusing on. In that sense, I don't think I will consider having another size. Size matters in that sense that I've struggled with the wind profile. So the wind profile that I'm generating with the fan is not necessarily a realistic wind profile, and that can maybe be solved by adapting the size of the wind tunnel. So those are my current thoughts on that. Thank you.
Yeah. And the another question by Bart is, how does the lack of the sediment influx, so there's no upwind supply, how does that affect your results, for example, the degrees of erodibility with time?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because you can argue that the erodibility is helped by the saltation process. So if you don't have upwind sediments coming in, you don't have this process of the saltation cascade, so that the sediments bump into each other and stuff. So maybe I should have a small hatch in the wind tunnel where I can study exactly that, where I can sprinkle sediment inside and see how this this will affect. So I think it's a very good question, Bart.
And there's time for one more. Did you have a look at the grain size during the experiment? So was the removed sediment of a similar grain size, or did that change with time?
Yeah, so we did. And we found variability, but I was not happy with the signal yet. So I don't really want to go into that yet. There is reasons to believe that there is some grain size selective process sorting sediment going on when winds goes over, but we did not find very strong evidence for that.
Okay. Okay, thank you. There are a couple of more questions, but because of time, I would like to continue to the next speaker. And of course, there's always the opportunity to see it. You can see the questions and perhaps respond directly or in another way during the conference. These questions can be readdressed.
Thank you.